Ladies and gentlemen, greetings. This is AIAA's short course, Fundamentals of Space Systems. I'm Mike Grontman, Professor of Astronautics and the course instructor. The course consists of 12 parts or 12 lectures. One can download the course notes, about 280 pages, as a PDF file. We start with lecture 1. Ready? Let us start the countdown. 4, 3, 2, 1, and liftoff! Fundamentals of Space Systems, Part 1. Course Scope, Content, and Organization. Space Enterprise. What we will do in this course, at first we will describe the structure and the content of the course. The course consists of 12 parts or lectures, and there are corresponding 12 sections of the course notes that is are available as PDF files. Each lecture lasts 50, 60, 70 minutes. And when the course is offered live, it is typically a two-day course, two full days, 8 or 9 hours per day. And this course is typically offered in conjunction with AIAA's conferences. Today, in this lecture, we will start with the course content, then we will talk about instructor. We'll discuss supporting materials, books, videos, and we briefly touch upon the units that are being used in space technology. Then we will switch gears and talk the second half of this lecture about the global space enterprise, about government and commercial space activities, national security, space policies, missions, satellites, and space mission concept. I want to say at the very beginning that the course notes have more materials that we can discuss during lectures. Sometimes we just briefly touch upon certain things, and you are expected on your own to look in the course notes for more details on this particular subject. So let's go. First of all, as I said, there are 12 parts or 12 lectures. We'll start in the beginning with this lecture one, about talking about the course organization and the space enterprise. Then in the next lecture, part two, we'll discuss the solar system, plasma, and the sun, basically environment where our spacecraft operates. And then we'll talk about coordinate systems that play particularly important role, because you have to describe where your satellites are and time. One of the coordinates that we have to use is also very important. Then we will talk about space environment in more details, and here there are two components. At first, we'll talk about space environments, what is out there, what are the events that are happening in space, and what is the nature of the events that surrounds us. And then the second part of that topic would be how the environment affects space systems, and this effect of the surrounding environment on satellites and spacecraft, space vehicles, determines how we design them, how we operate them, and bring a number of important constraints. Then we'll start in a part four, orbital mechanics. We'll talk about the basics at first, and in the following section, section five or part five, we'll discuss common orbits that the satellites fly in space, and we'll also touch upon mission geometry, basically what you can see from a satellite and from what parts of the ground you can communicate with satellites. Section six is on facilities in operations, the facilities that support or infrastructure that supports our space operations, operations in space. We will also briefly touch upon the space mission design overview, what it takes to get from a concept to implementing the mission. It's a multiple steps, and so what it takes to get there. So, and systems engineering will be a part of the discussion then. Then we have the next section on spacecraft propulsion. So basically, in the previous sections, on the space environment, orbital mechanics, and space operations, we established constraints where our satellites operate, how they fly in space, what is possible, where you could be, and what is the environment. And now we're switching gears, we are going into a particular satellite systems that should be on board to implement our desire, our desires, our vision of space mission. So we'll start with the spacecraft propulsion and basically how the rocket systems work for satellite maneuvering and for rocketry, for launching satellite from the ground and bringing them to space. Then part 8 would be devoted to the space launch systems. And then in part 9 we will consider one of the most important subsystem on any satellite, that is spacecraft attitude determination and control, ADC. How you control orientation of the space satellites, how you do maneuvering, what is possible there, what are the main constraints and drivers. Then in part 10 we will talk about communications. It's basically communications between a satellite and a ground station, or it could be a communications between the satellites. In part 11 we'll consider another most important satellite subsystem, spacecraft electric power subsystem, providing electrical power. And here there is this photovoltaic arrays, solar cells, and then there are other possibilities, nuclear systems. And then we'll talk also about the thermal control of satellites, which is just very, very important because the conditions in space are very different from what we have on Earth, on the ground. And finally, in part 12, we will take everything that we discussed in our course and we will consider space missions and applications in the 21st century, what people do in space. And this discussion would be much more informed because it is based on the previous topics that we considered, the orbital mechanics, environment, attitude determination, control of satellites, their propulsion, communications, power, satellite power. This discussion of the space missions and applications would give us a very good perspective what is being done in space in the 21st century and what is just coming even in the future. And this is in the commercial space, in the science exploration, in national security, in other topics. In summary, this course provides an overview of the fundamentals of concepts and technologies of modern space systems. Remember that space mission and space system design are an essentially interdisciplinary sport. You have various areas of science and engineering combined together. There are also external phenomena, so it's becoming, again, very diverse areas. It requires scientific and engineering knowledge coming from all possible in all possible flavors. We will concentrate on scientific and engineering foundations of space systems and how these subsystems interact or affect each other, and the latter immediately brings importance of systems engineering. We will introduce the basic nomenclature, vocabulary and concepts, and this would allow one to discuss with a subsystem specialist his or her particular area of work. Basically, no pundit will ever snow you, because again, sometimes you hear it's very important sounding words and phrases, they're intimidating, but if you know what is behind those concepts, you would understand what's happening there, so this will help you to navigate this with ease. The course is designed for engineers, program development specialists, and managers who are involved in planning, designing, building, launching, and operating space systems. And particularly for the engineers and managers who are coming to space from other areas of work, engineering work, but they're just moving into the space technology. This course familiarizes with the global technology in space, with the fundamentals of space systems. So a few words about your instructor. I'm Mike Grundtvig. I'm a space physicist and I'm an engineer. I'm a professor of astronautics at the University of Southern California, and I'm also a professor of aerospace and mechanical engineering there. I am the founder of the space program at the USC, my university, space engineering program. And I served as the founding chairman of the pure space engineering department in 2004-2007 that USC established. Typically, space engineering is part of aerospace engineering departments, and we split from aerospace and we form a dedicated space engineering department. This is a unique department in the country. I also served as a chairman, actually, very recently again. The administrative tasks are not very interesting, but we have to do our service. My detailed biographical sketch is on the next page. You are free just to look at that in detail if you're interested. But basically, I'm again a space physicist and space engineer. I'm a specialist in astronautics, space physics, sensors, instrumentation, space missions, propulsion, rocketry. I served and I serve now as a co-investigator on a few NASA missions. I engaged in the research and development programs in space technologies also with other government agencies. In addition to NASA, I published a large number of scholarly articles, books, and all that. So I have a website. It's my website. There should be com, letter M is missing here, and my email if you ever need to contact me. This is a detailed my biographical sketch, so you can look at that. What are the recommended materials for this course? Well, first of all, there are course notes for this particular course, Fundamentals of Space Systems, there on the top. Now, below are listed two publications. The first one is the Space Mission Analysis and Design, known as SMAD. So SMAD was the most widely used book. You could find it on a bookshelf of practically every space engineer working in a space area. This book, the first editions, particularly the second one and the third one in 1990s, again, became extremely widely used worldwide. Every space engineer had it. And in 2011, the new edition was published. The same authors or editors, because these books are a compilation of contributions by specialists in the field. The new edition, the new SMAD as it is known, has become the replacement for SMAD. Again, it's very widely used. But if you have the old version, please do not dispose that. Keep it, because while the new SMAD repeated a number of fundamental, foundational topics in space engineering, it also added the new topics. And because the volume of the book grew dramatically of the new SMAD, it's really a big, heavy brick. Because of that, some topics from the old edition were discarded, but they still are foundational. So both of these editions are very important. And there's also another publication just coming from a different group of authors, Fundamentals of Space Systems, that is more sort of a science-oriented on the fundamentals of satellite subsystems. In addition to these two books, there are a very large number of publications. At the bottom there is a website. This is the website that I maintain that lists a large number of publications there. These next two slides, two dozens of books in various areas of satellite technology listed here. And again, at the bottom there is a website that lists 10 times more titles of books, and they are compartmented in the different areas: attitude determination and control, spacecraft dynamics, orbital mechanics, propulsion, and so on and so forth. What are other sources of information? So we already talked about the books. On my website I have, this is the URL, I have about one dozen short video clips, approximately 5 minutes long each. It's more than 1 million views on YouTube, and these video clips demonstrate or illustrate evolution of spacecraft orbits. Now, if your background is not in orbital mechanics, a lot of concepts talking about regression of nodes or rotation of the line of apsides and other very important concepts that describe what's happening with the orbits of satellites, and we will be talking more about that in the orbital mechanics part of this course. So, but a lot of these concepts, these are very hard to visualize if you are not from this particular engineering area. These videos that just demonstrate evolution of orbits, I can tell you that watching how the orbit evolves in time is not very exciting. It's boring, like watching the paint drying, but it's very important. It provides a very good visualization what is happening with when you put satellites in orbits. And satellites never stay in an orbit where you put it, because there is some disturbing forces, as we'll discuss during in this course later, that will start changing the orbital properties of satellites. So it's again, it's about one dozen video clips there, 5 minutes long. They're all on YouTube, so you can watch them and pull them out and study in the detail if needed. Then there are obviously publications of professional societies in addition to books. It's journals, conference proceedings, textbooks. They're very important. And there are a lot of information on the World Wide Web. Here one have to be careful, as with almost everything on the World Wide Web, because we have some very useful and solid information there, especially a number of PDF files of government reports or technical manuals or even technical publications are there. And then there are, since nobody really controls that, what's going up there, so there are a number of postings of basically garbage. It's a lot of inaccurate information, so you have to be careful. And this is like with everything else on the web. There are a lot of fake stuff, fake news, I mean, basically uninformed things are there, but a lot of very, very good things, so it's a judgment is needed. Professional societies play a very important role in space technology, as in any other area of science and engineering. So it's very important if you are getting into the space area to become a member of a technical society. It provides networking, opens very important connections, and then the publications, technical publications of the societies and conferences and the meetings, forums are very, very important. In space engineering, the primary society is the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, AIAA, this course is part of one of the AIAA's courses. But there are a number of other societies that engaged in various aspects of space technology, and just I listed just a few: American Astronautical Society, American Geophysical Union, American Physical Society, IEEE, OSA, SPIE, and many, many others. And finally, in this first half of this lecture, a note on the units and constants. The aerospace field is famous or notorious, depending on your perspective, on using all kinds of units. There are metric units, there are imperial units, there are other non-system units, and the situation is not going to change regardless whatever regulators or just governments may tell us to do or what not to do. Because of that, it's very important to be very, very confident in juggling with the units, to be confident in using different units. It doesn't mean that you have to be able to, say, do estimates or solve problems in different systems of units. You do it in your preferred systems, just in the metric system, for example. But you take the parameters that are given in other system of units, convert to your preferred system, do your calculations or consider what's happening, do your design, and then when you get the results, you convert them to the system of units desired by your customer, because you cannot tell to a customer that, well, you don't know the units, so you just cannot do the job. You will lose that particular customer then. A few units and constants listed here, so will help you in this course. It's inches, mils, one thousandth of an inch, important units. And again, we'll be talking during the course, you will see them. But in, again, in the technical literature, particularly in the United States, you will see this a combination of various units. This is like this page, this slide is for reference. The next slide is a compilation of a few important physical constants that are being used. And I also want to provide you two URLs, two links to the resources on the web. The National Institute of Standards and Technology, the former Bureau of Standards, has a website where there is in the document, so I'm giving this URL here, and on this website they're changing URLs inside. There will be a possibility to download this document as a PDF. This document is a guide to the use of metric SI, International System of Units. Although it's a guide to use the metric units, it has a very extensive list of conversion from non-metric units to metric units. So it's basically you pull out this document, you print it, I think it's 50 or 100 pages, you print it, you one time, put it on your bookshelf, and it will stay for you for the decades. It will be a very, very helpful resource. The National Institute of Standards and Technology is also the main repository of the physical constants and all that. So they have also a website from where you can download the latest definitions of main physical constants. Although the physical constants really do not change much, and if they slightly adjusted, it very unlikely would affect your applications. But still, this is a very nice compilation from the ultimate authority in the country on the constants. So these two documents just would be very important to download and just keep them on the bookshelf. Now let us switch the gears and talk about space enterprise. Space plays an important role in the everyday life, and its role actually increases all the time. It affects government, business, culture. Many countries project military power, commercial interest, national image, prestige. It's also truly technological frontier. It's expensive, and it is also government controlled or government regulated. Immediately tells us that the role of national policies and sometimes even politics become very important. and it's also international in its nature. There is an elite club of 11 countries that build their own satellites and launch them into space on their own space launchers. It started with the Soviet Union and then the United States. Then it was followed by France, Japan, the People's Republic of China, United Kingdom. After that, there was national space launch programs in Europe stopped. Europe, Western Europe, combined its resources in the European Space Agency. And the European Space Agency would later start ESA, would start launching its own satellites on its own rocket launchers. Then India launched its own satellite, Israel, Iran, North Korea, and then the South Korea. European countries, as we mentioned, participate through the European Space Agency, ESA. In addition to this elite club, many, many countries bought and operate commercial satellites. They are launched by countries that are capable of launching satellites. So the number of countries that bought satellites or even started to build their own, but they are launched by other countries for them, is growing dramatically. Many countries experiment with space technology. So this brings an issue of proliferation of the technology, because in science and engineering, really, there is no such a thing as a civilian science or civilian technology. All science, knowledge, and all technology are dual use. There are many dimensions of space exploration: science, technology, economics, industry, national prestige, international relations, and so on and so forth. If I look at the global space in terms of, in economic terms, on the left, you see that the globally space enterprise growing, and today it's more than $400 billion per year. These numbers that are given here, they are approximate, and one of the reasons is that the way how they are calculated evolves with time, and then the currencies fluctuate, but it shows you the significant growth. For the last 15 years, it's roughly 6, 7, 8% per year. There was a growth of the international space enterprise. The American economy, infrastructure, and national security depend on satellites more than those of any other nation. Until mid-1990s, government expenditures in space dominated. So then the situation began to change, and today commercial space dominates. Out of these $400+ billion annually, governments in the world spend less than one quarter, close to $90 billion. The United States government spends one half, or even more than one half, of what other governments spend globally on space. The United States government is very active in space, and in a second you would see the numbers from a different perspective. Europe is four times smaller than the United States, and there is the breakdown of the main countries that spend money in space. It's governments. In addition to Europe, there's Canada has a space program. Obviously, the Soviet Union or Russia today has a major program. The People's Republic of China has a rapidly growing program. India, Japan has a healthy program, and many other countries. Then there is also non-US military space. Total combines about $10 billion. In a moment, we'll talk about United States military expenditures in space. In 2004, I made a statement, and I got actually a lot of flack from some European friends, unfortunately, especially. And I just basically wrote that only France and the old Soviet Union in the past approaches the United States space expenditures in terms of the fraction of the gross domestic product. Other countries spend like 4 to 5 times less governments than the United States government. table on the left demonstrates that. So you see, this is the expenditures of the United States and all European countries and Japan. They spent, if you look here carefully at this table, at when you have time, you will see that they are spending really 4 and 5 times less than the United States. This is basically nothing change in terms of this ratio during the last 15 years. Russia and the Soviet Union in the past spends about the same as the United States as a fraction of GDP, the gross domestic product. We don't know too much about China because it's a communist country. Their economy or accounting is not transparent, so it's hard to say, but you can be assured that China spends probably even more than the United States as a fraction of the gross domestic product. But it's important that, again, in terms of government spending, European countries and Japan spend significantly less, and so they are basically not committed to the space exploration and space technology to the same degree as the United States government. Now, if you look at the space employment in industry in the red and in the government agencies in blue, also the United States dominates with these numbers. We don't have numbers for China or for Russia to that matter, really. But you can see that the United States commercially, it's almost 150,000, and Europe total just three times less, and there's a breakdown according to the countries. If you look at the government employment, NASA is about 70,000, and then there's a military, approximately the same number of employees, and the other government agencies in other countries. I know that the India has a very large number of the government employees working in space. Look at this table at the time convenient for you. Let me just talk a little bit about United States government space programs, and there's an illustration here that the numbers that we have, they are approximate, and it's because it's not clear how to tabulate them. The first of all, traditionally people talk about that, well, in the United States there are two government programs, civilian and military. Well, in reality, there are three government programs. They occasionally talk to each other, they occasionally cooperate with each other, and sometimes they don't talk to each other and operate independently. And their size not very much different from each other. These are the civilian program. This is primarily NASA. And then there is a military, which is a Department of Defense. And then there is the intelligence community. It's basically space reconnaissance. So in the national security space, these two programs, they are not very much different in scope and in the contributions. But when people talk about the military space, they usually do not distinguish them. But again, these are the two programs with the two stovepipes, as the people would say, in government. These are the two programs that occasionally talk to each other, and sometimes they don't talk to each other. And in addition to these three main government programs, we have a commercial space that is very heavily government regulated for obvious reasons. It's national security and safety. If we look at some numbers on the right of the government, so these are from the Space Foundation, just the current numbers saying United States government $48 billion, but this is without intelligence program, without that one. And the breakdown, so it's about half of this government spending shown on the right is Department of Defense, it's military space, and then there is a NASA and just a little bit sprinkles across other departments in the federal government. How much goes to the intelligence? Space reconnaissance is a classified number, but for a couple of years it was not classified. So in 2010, for example, National Reconnaissance Office and National Geospatial Intelligence Agency, that were close to $17 billion in 2010. It just tells you that this is about the same as the Department of Defense spends. Basically, you can think about the United States government programs, three programs roughly the same size: Department of Defense, Reconnaissance, and NASA, civilian space. In addition, there is the Missile Defense Agency that spending between $9 and $11 billion each year, and they relies very heavily on the technologies, either space technology or close relations to space technologies. And these kind of expenditures, it's again, they're linked to space. If you look in the, from the engineering point of view, the same contractors that are working in the military space, intelligence community space, and the NASA, the same industrial contractors engaged in the missile defense work. This could be considered as the part, at least, of the space engineering, and we'll talk about a little bit more about that in our last lecture, lecture 12, when we'll discuss what is being done in the 21st century. Otherwise, if we forget about, again, this missing intelligence contribution, so the United States government, $48 billion, which is 11% of the total global space, commercial and government across the world. Commercial space dominates 55%. And then there is a commercial space infrastructure. We'll talk in a second about that. It's one quarter of the total expenditures. What is being done in the government civilian space and the commercial space? First of all, on the left, government civilian space, it's a science and exploration. And here there are two main thrusts. First, we explore the solar system, the sun, the universe from the point of advancing scientific knowledge. We want to learn about the nature. The second thrust is our spacecraft operate in space environment, and we want to know how the magnetospheres, the sun's activities, and everything else affects our space system. So there is this applied component. This is the government civilian space is focused on these two thrusts, to learn about nature and apply our understanding to understanding of the environment, space environment, and interactions on the space systems. There are Earth orbiting satellites doing that. They study near Earth environment, atmosphere, ionosphere, magnetosphere. They study the sun. Then there are satellites that go to other planets that they're in the interplanetary space on, and then do planetary exploration. Then they will have a very large program in the human exploration. It's the International Space Station. Again, in section 12, last section of this course, we'll talk more about that, and they're going to Moon, Mars, and beyond. There are government satellites doing weather, then the space weather, remote sensing, and many other things. In terms of the human space flight, there was a major decision made in 2017, the so-called Space Policy Directive 1, that the United States will lead the return of humans to the moon for long-term exploration, and then we'll go to Mars and beyond. We'll talk in section 12 of the course. In terms of commercial, a lot of things are being done. Direct TV, communications, satellite radio. So now you buy a car and it has a Sirius XM satellite radio there. Imaging, study of the Earth resources, space tourism is coming, and many other things. In terms of numbers of expenditures, on the right, we have some number. The commercial space products, $220 billion internationally. What is the leading industry in space? This is direct-to-home TV, close to $100 billion. Look at the space satellite communications, through the satellites. It's four times smaller. Earth observation, remote sensing, significantly smaller. Satellite radio, now $8 billion, again, also smaller. So it's direct-to-home TV dominates. Another huge area is PNT, positioning, navigation, and timing. We'll be talking more during the, in the course later about that. This is basically GPS, the Global Positioning System, and its analogs by developed by other countries. And we know that GPS is ubiquitous, just in almost everywhere we have it. And then there's a commercial space infrastructure, which is primarily ground stations and equipment that supporting our satellites, getting data from satellites, communicates with them, and so on and so forth. And there's some other minor activities. Because what happens in space is either government controlled or government regulated. Because of that, space policies, national space policies, and politics because of that become very, very important. Government regulates space because of the security, safety, and the economy, and the export control, and other things. National security involved, economic competitiveness involved, it's national prestige also, and a lot of, again, in the government control space, it's a lot of public funding goes there. Now, the United States publishes national space policy. Basically, every presidential administration issues its space policy. I have on the web, actually on my website, you can pull out and see the national space policies 2006. It's under President George W. Bush. Then President Obama issued the policy in 2010. And very recently, in December of 2020, President Trump issued his policy. When the space policy is made public, usually in the mainstream media, you can't really understand or learn much, because either journalists are lazy or uninformed, or combination thereof, and the political biases and all that. It's that really misrepresents the policy. So perhaps laziness plays the most important role there. But the trade media, such as the Aviation Week and Space Technology, Space News, Aerospace America, AIAA's publications, usually very good, and you will just learn what is there. There are many space policies issues of importance. So, for example, I listed on the right some of them. So, freedom of space is basically, can you fly over other countries' territories? Can your satellites fly over? Today, it's no question. They can, but in the beginning of the space ages was the main one of the main issues and the questions. Military activities of space. We cannot even agree what military activities are. So, because again, everything is just so combined in the science and technology. The human space flight versus space science and exploration. The tensions between the human space flight or proponents of the human space flight and the robotic science exploration were from the day one of the space program in the United States. From the day one, from the late 1950s and early 60s. And it continues. You hear the calls, well, we don't need the International Space Station, let's spend money on science. And but a lot of public support comes because of the human space flight for government space. It's again, the space scientists and engineers should really be more careful in what they say publicly, because if we get into the too much of a fight among ourselves, we can lose support of public, and we will lose both. Then industrial base in critical technologies. This is a very important issue, because how much government should do in space? Because we would like to have private companies to do things. On the other hand, certain technologies that are essential, indispensable for space, they are not very profitable. And the companies would rather do things in the commercial world that will bring profit, but government needs them to do it. For example, radiation-hardened circuitry, integrated circuits that could operate in space, the radiation-hardened, or solid rockets with large diameter that is needed for example, for the ICBMs launched from submarines or from silos. And if you do not continue these developments in industry, you may lose the technological expertise, because you cannot learn many things in textbooks. You have really to pass the experience of one generation of engineers to another. And if you don't have the programs, R&D, research and development programs in a certain areas, then sooner or later you would lose expertise as the people retire. Again, industrial base in critical technologies. The government and industry role in space technology development, we already mentioned that. Its interaction between government and private industry. International competition. How much we should compete, and is this competition fair? One has to say that practically no space launcher was ever developed until very recently, purely commercially. There was a government subsidies in all countries in different shapes and forms. So you have to be just careful when you call for the open competition, because the competition very rarely is open. Allocation of radio frequency bands, nuclear power in space, technology transfer and export controls are very important from the national security point of view, and orbital debris challenge. This is something, a growing problem, so we have more and more stuff flying there, and we will talk a little bit more about that in the space environment part of this course. If you look at the space mission, any space mission, there are three components. First of all, you have to have a payload, a sensor, or something that does useful thing in space, either measure certain particles, fields, or take pictures of astronomical objects, or maybe looking down on Earth for remote sensing or reconnaissance or doing something. There's a payload. Then you need a spacecraft, sometimes called a spacecraft bus, on which this payload flies. And this spacecraft bus provides a structure, it provides resources, power, communications, capabilities, orientation control, and all that to a payload to operate. So you need a spacecraft and payload, and you deploy them in space. Then you need a ground facilities as on the ground that would interact with your spacecraft, communicate, control it. And as we saw in the economic part of this, of the data just a few minutes ago, this ground infrastructure is very expensive. It just takes a lot of expenditures, significant part of the space enterprise. And then the third main component is space launcher. So you build the spacecraft and the payload, and in order to deploy in orbit, you need a huge rockets. And there's space launchers that will put your spacecraft into orbit. There's three main components always in space missions. So another question is, where are our satellites? Most of the satellites are in the so-called low Earth orbit, LEO. This is a view just shown here of our Earth to scale with the most of the satellites, and they are in the shell. You could think about this about 1,000 kilometers or 600 or 700 miles thick. Earth diameter is roughly 12,000 kilometers. This is to scale. Most of the satellites are there. If I step away from the Earth and I look as shown just right here, I would see that in addition to satellites around the Earth, low Earth orbit, there is a ring of satellites. And this ring of satellites would be at altitude 35,800 kilometers. This is the so-called geostationary orbit. A satellite in this orbit appears stationary for observer on the ground. It basically revolves around the Earth with the same rate as the Earth spins on its axis. So we'll talk in the orbital mechanics more about that. This is a geostationary orbit. This is where most of the satellites are, low Earth orbit and some in the geostationary orbit. And of course, there are a few satellites on interplanetary trajectories that are going to other planets for exploration. And one day we'll have an interstellar craft leaving our solar system. A launch is very expensive. And for many years, the cost of launching, say, 1 kilogram to low Earth orbit was about $10,000. Now, the launch cost is decreasing. This is the phenomenon of the last several years. There's a growing competition among various space launches. SpaceX also contributed to changing the way how the business is being done. So the cost is decreasing, but it's still very expensive. And the cost of satellite launch is perhaps the largest obstacle to flourishing and rapidly growing commercial space. Although now the commercial space grows, the cost is going down, and we will see more and more of these tendencies. As the cost of the space launch becomes smaller and smaller, there will be more and more activities in space, and there will be more and more challenges with debris problem. But anyway, keep in mind this number for the rough estimate. So for many years it was $10,000 per 1 kilogram to place in the low Earth orbit, and today just it's a little bit just lower. If I look at the space mission concept, everything is driven by the mission goals. Very few cases now when the countries fly just a satellite to show the flag, just for the prestige purposes. For the big countries, it is in the past. Today we fly spacecraft to do something in space, to do remote sensing, some military activities, communications, or to perform particular scientific measurements and exploration. There's a mission goals is something that drives the mission. So in order to achieve the goals, we have to have a payload that would on board of satellite that would achieve this mission goals. Then we have to have the spacecraft bus, as we already introduced this term, basically a payload rides on a bus, and the bus provides all the resources for the payload to operate. Now we also have to have a launch system to put our spacecraft into the right orbit to achieve the mission goals. And when I am in orbit, I need attitude determination control. And again, we will be discussing it later in the course. We have to navigate and maintain the orbit. We'll discuss it later in the course. We have to have a command, control, and communications capabilities, and we need to power our spacecraft, and we need to provide thermal control there. So we'll again, we'll be discussing this during our course later. And then, finally, we have a very important component, mission operations. Mission operations that will control the spacecraft during the mission, receive the data, store them, and distribute to the users. And there's number of the bits coming from space growing dramatically. It takes more and more effort to do that. And then you have to control the spacecraft from the ground. All these components have to be tied up together in order to have a mission that would successfully achieve its goals. The system engineering becomes very important because many areas of science and engineering are involved, and you have to make sure that all these blue circles, they talk to each other, and the engineers talk to each other and combine all these components into the mission. This is the end of lecture one of the course Fundamentals of Space Systems. Ad Astra.